Thank you so much, Charlotte, all my colleagues and friends, and my thanks as well to Dan Wilson, who began a conversation with me about addressing the society in 2018 and even encouraged me to include Alfred North Whitehead in my remarks. Lastly, many thanks to the organizers of our gathering, including Jane Lewin and Kevin Hilliard, who brought us into this virtual space from so many places to share our thoughts about Goethe. Ever since I witnessed the first meeting of the EVG that was held outside Germany in Princeton, I'm sorry to admit over 50 years ago, having some personal connection with the English Goethe Society has been a professional ambition. I suppose that was because as a 23-year-old graduate student in Spain, and rather uncertain at the time whether I should pursue legal or literary studies, I met Elizabeth Mary Wilkinson in Princeton, where she spoke about Faust's translation of John's Logos. Among all the notable participants at the event, which was attended by many of Europe and America's most celebrated Germanists, Professor Wilkinson stood out as the most memorable to me. Along with my Princeton teachers, the late Ted Zilkowski, Stanley Korngold, hi Stanley, and
Hello.
Victor Lange, who had organized the meeting, she, Professor Wilkinson, subsequently became the most consequential scholar for my evolving view of what German studies outside the German-speaking world can and should do to distinguish itself from Germanistik. With this in mind and in preparation for today's talk, I decided to return to Wilkinson's seminal essay of 1952, The Poet as Thinker, which offers an extended reflection on what she then called, in an oblique reference to Alfred North Whitehead, Goethe's varying modes of thought. As I read on, it did not surprise me to find the scholarly erudition, critical acumen, and graceful language of her article still as fresh as when this and other Wilkinson gems on Goethe and Company had begun attracting my attention decades ago. And I continue to regard her essays as models for the kind of rigorous and accessible dialogue between philosophy and literature that I have aspired to emulate in my own work, however imperfectly. By way of transition to my remarks on Goethe's lyrical exploration of philosophical conceptualization in Prometheus and Ganymede, I'll risk any unfavorable comparisons with her work and linger a bit with the poet as thinker. By linking Whitehead's arcane and daunting terminology to a few conceptual propositions in Wilkinson's article on some now all too familiar modes of thought in Goethe, I hope firstly to defamiliarize a few of his signature concepts that after decades of citation are in perpetual danger of becoming meaningless placeholders and paraphrases. Denn eben, wo Begriffe fehlen, Mephisto quips in the second study scene, da stellt ein Wort zur rechten Zeit sich ein. I take it those who don't have German can read this on the screen. Secondly, however, if Whiteheadian expressions like prehension, concrescence, the lure of feeling, subject, superject, nexus, actual event, objective datum, and eternal object seem too obscure or too idiosyncratic to illuminate analogous concepts constitutive of Goethe's thought processes, the lucidity and explicatory power of Wilkinson's writing about the poet's conceptual lexicon can serve as a bridge between Whitehead's process philosophy and the German antecedent's morphological way of thinking. Consider for an example an aside in The Poet and Thinker about Goethe's naive conviction in the Kant essay of 1820, Einwirkung der Neueren Philosophie, where he confesses, certainly tongue in cheek, to doing philosophy mit unbewusster Naivität. According to Wilkinson's deft summary, The Cartesian dichotomy of subject and object, which just a few paragraphs earlier she had explicitly linked to Whitehead's bifurcation of nature, quote, was for Goethe at most an instrument for one kind of thinking, never an actual experience of severance, unquote. So much is compressed into this observation about Goethe's reflections on his proto-philosophical disposition in Einwirkung and his dialogic thinking that we feel prompted to expand it in pursuit of conceptual correspondences and divergences in his and Whitehead's respective modes of thought. First, by moving back and forth between the autobiographical confession and Kant's first and second critiques, and then from there onto Whitehead's concept of nature and process and reality. In just a few short paragraphs, Wilkinson's comment puts Goethe's Selbst and Außenwelt into play with the Cartesian and Kantian subjects, and then these two positions implicitly with Whitehead's transformation of subjectivity into the subjective form that he called subject-superject. As an experimental observer, this innovative reconfiguration of Kant's transcendental subject in a radical reversal of Kantian constructivism inverts its central doctrine of, quote, the objective world as a construct of subject experience, unquote. That is to say, the Whiteheadian subject-superject replaces Kant's, quote, knowable world of categorical forms and apparent objectivity, unquote, with a rival doctrine that explains the process of understanding as proceeding from objectivity for subjectivity, for which the external world is a datum. That's all from Process and Reality. Now, I could go on to discuss Whitehead's reconceptualization of the objects of all philosophical dualisms as the objective data given to feeling, and in turn connect them to Goethe, quote, die Meinungen der Philosophen, which according to Einwirkung flowed into Goethe's own edification as a heterodox thinker, and that he came to treat as Whiteheadian objective data avant la lettre. Or I could put the word Einwirkung itself in dialogue with Whitehead's analysis of the ingression of the pure potentialities he calls eternal objects into the construction of the real in the context of Wilkinson's account of Goethe's communication with the not-self. But my time is short, and I should get on with my Whitehead-inspired reading of Prometheus Ganymede, Dyad, as part of the poet's lifelong experimentation with the power of philosophical conceptualization to mediate self and world. Das Gedicht als Vermittler von Objekt und Subjekt. In what follows, then, I'm asking you to imagine Goethe thinking with Whitehead, to borrow a phrase from the title of Isabel Stengel's magisterial book on the Anglo-American philosopher's, quote, free and wild creation of concepts. My reading of Goethe's exemplary lyrical documents will consider the role they played in the joint construction of his nascent philosophical concept by featuring figures of thought that are embedded in the word families of the verbs fassen, greifen, and fangen. When taken together as a single conceptual concrescence, each of these lexemes resonates with a pronouncement that Wilkinson attributed to Whitehead's Harvard colleague John Dewey in The Poet as Thinker. Reality, Dewey maintained, is not just given to the mind, but taken by it. In accord with this observation, I want to argue that Whitehead's neologism prehend subsumes an extensive series of verbs of grasping and taking that Goethe had deployed more than a century earlier as a crucial move in constructing the emergent reality of his own mind and its mental operations as a virtual lexicon of philosophical concepts, one that I hope we're realizing as a real lexicon today. In addition to fassen, greifen, and fangen, these verbs include closely related words like erfassen, verfassen, umfassen, along with synonyms such as begreifen and ergreifen, and the word umfangen, which the poem Ganymede prominently features as its final point of inflection. Importantly, all of these conceptually configured verbs suggest both physical and mental activities, and all are grounded in a feeling that in Whitehead's formulation has a, quote, subjective aim. That is to say, like anything doing what a thing does, a dog barking at a squirrel, for example, Goethe's verbs of grasping are purposive. They are predications of a subject that aims at a satisfaction, catching and eating a squirrel. Another Whiteheadian concept, by achieving some value. Ganymede's extended arm as an organ in the process of conceptualization aims to reach out and to grasp. Here then my thesis for today, a rather long statement. Promethean and Ganymedean purposiveness express contrasting subjective aims, term from Whitehead. Each of Goethe's mythological figures is driven by a primordial feeling to move along a distinct path of satisfaction. But when taken together and collected as a dynamic nexus, the sum of their moves or concrescences of their physical and mental prehensions constitute a unified force field of conceptualization that is post-theological and proto-philosophical. As Wilkins' seminal essay on the theological basis of Faust's credo first established, the Allumfasser, Allerhalter, whom Faust names in response to Gretchen's "Glaubst du an Gott?" locates the ineffable cause of all things, the primal creator, in complementary asks of grasping and sustaining. Fasst und erhält er nicht dich, mich selbst, sich selbst. For Goethe, then, the ultimate generative principle is a Spinoza-inspired Godhead or single substance that both contains and sustains everything under the attributes of extension and thought. To be enveloped in God, umfangen, is to achieve both physical and mental satisfaction. In pursuit of such satisfaction, the subject-superject functions at work. In the Prometheus Ganymede dyad, both expend Gefühl in a rhythmically patterned process of pulses of emotion. And according to Wilkinson's final footnote in Faust's Credo, such moments of affective pulsation also belong to the semantic field of greifen, ergreifen, fassen, erfassen, etc. Quote, diese Stole und Diastole des menschlichen Geistes, Goethe recalls in Einwirkung, war mir wie ein zweites Atemholen, niemals getrennt, immer pulsierend. This rhythmic configuration of the full potential of mental life suggests that for Goethe, ideas are always embodied. They have an essential somatic component that makes them available for further reflection in sense and aesthetic experiences. Conceptual personae, according to Deleuze and Guattari in What is Philosophy, inhabit philosophical writing and, quote, play a part in the very creation of a philosopher's concepts, unquote. Often nameless, we are told, but at times also associated with a proper name, like Socrates, these subterranean figures of thought, quote, must always be reconstituted by the reader, unquote. And when configured in conversation with rival voices, as in Platonic dialogues, a chorus of conceptual personae can, like the energetic Altgeist in Faust, catch, fold, and ceaselessly weave on its, quote, own giant shuttle, the alternating tos and fros of body and mind, or nature fuses and thought nous into a textual plane of immanence. Interestingly, something both Whiteheadian and Goethean is at work in Deleuze's late 20th century creation myth of philosophy. Accordingly, my framing of the Prometheus Ganymede nexus will move along an arc that reaches forward toward the French philosopher's figuration of divine immanence almost two centuries later as a composed chaos. By reading the opposing monologues of Prometheus and Ganymede dialogically, in terms of the reciprocal engagement, moreover, or in the language of Deleuze and Guattari, by reconstituting the distinct conceptual personae of the two odes as conflicting lyrical voices in friendly conversation with each other, I will show or outline in broad strokes how these early lyrical texts rethink the relationship between the distinct qualities that constitute the dynamic textuality of the Promethean-Ganymedean dyad. And this reconceptualization of their speakers' intertwined trajectories between the infinite and finite will allow me in turn to frame the well-known pairing of the poems in all authorized editions of Goethe's collected works since Gershon in a way that features their oppositional structure, or what Goethe would call their polarität, as a reflection on the dynamic process of philosophical conceptualization. This is not to say that either of the texts is already and definitively conceptual or philosophic, but their pairing as polar contrasts allows us to situate them in preconceptual and proto-philosophical field of potentiality, where according to Goethe's appropriation from Schelling's Ideen, the opposing vectors of body and mind can coexist in, quote, a philosophical state of nature. Ultimately, the ode shared figural investments and oppositional structures together demarcate a new Goethean plane of physical and mental activity that I read as the condition of possibility for a divinely authored process of becoming conceptual and therefore also becoming philosophical. In order to track this lyrical journey in philosophical conceptualization, I'll need to rehearse Goethe's parallel pairing of the poem's contrasting mythological masks. Whatever distinguishes the Promethean and Ganymedean points of view, however, like Spinoza's divine attributes, extension and thought, each of these subjectivities stands in reciprocal relation to a single principle of divine immanence, Spinoza's substance, and its modal expressions. That is to say, both Promethean materialism and Ganymedean idealism depend upon and develop from Whitehead would conceptualize as, quote, prehensions of or concrete facts of relatedness to a divine power. And when taken together, these contrasting modes of thought produce an ultimate connexus or connectedness or a hen kai pan. Thus, the Titan's juridically framed command to Zeus that he exit the stage of human activity paradoxically attaches him by way of his theft of the divine flame to the Olympian gods. Grounded in feelings of fear and hate, however, the renegade's rejection of Zeus in the damning speech act of his poem's opening strophe is, in Whiteheadian terms, a negative prehension. That is to say, Prometheus's initial outburst is actually a grabbing or grasping by the retrospective imagination, as Christian Weber has suggested. More a recollection generated by negative affects than an autonomous act of rebellion. Once enunciated, this prehension actually recreates the authority figure in an initial concrescence of rebellious subjectivity that forever connects the Promethean subject to the god. As David Welbery first demonstrated, before maturing into a prototypical homo faba, Prometheus was a reactive child of verbal daunts and violent games, whose feelings of resentment, along with the mental and physical acts of negative prehension these feelings produced, prepared the way for something there from the past to become something here in the present. Prometheus thereby also initiated the transformation of his negative energy into the heilig glühend Herz that, according to his lyrical narrative, had once thankfully accepted its own subjugation to the royal divinity. Und glühtest jungen gut, betrogen, Rettungsdank dem Schlafenden da droben. Now, the relationship of Prometheus's negative prehensions of Zeus as a deluded child to the youthful Ganymede's positive prehensions of an alluring and ambiguously sexualized Göttnatur at the beginning of the hymn is complicated. On the one hand, Prometheus exemplifies a kind of materialism, but his worldly creations and activities are rooted in the retrospective imagination and its mental reconstruction of divine authority as a distant memory that continues to repel him. On the other hand, Ganymede, who exemplifies a kind of idealism, conversely imagines divine causality as a natural process of formation through a series of positive prehensions or acts of physical grasping fasten that have their source in aesthetically configured sensation of beauty. Deiner ewigen Wärme heilig Gefühl, he says, unendliche Schöne. Propelled by the perspective imagination, Ganymede thus initially reaches out and into his surroundings with an outstretched arm to take physical hold of whatever out there attracted his attention in the first place. Lest we forget, however, Prometheus's retrospective imaginings paradoxically reanimate Zeus as a force of nature by implicitly connecting him with Jupiter Pluvius, the sturmatmende Gottheit in Wanderer's Sturmlied, whose life breath consists of the same elements, fire, earth, and water, that Prometheus combines to shape and animate in his autonomous act of rebellion into terracotta human beings. Okay. The positive prehensions of Ganymede's prospective imagination, which are propelled by idealist feelings of love and hope, similarly launch his journey through an extensive world or ecosystem of earthly things and animated creatures that he will gradually embrace and ultimately comprehend within a divine principle of creation. Lured by an overarching feeling associated with the red glow of his natural surroundings at sunrise, which is a concrescence or objectification of Promethean subjectivity and its heilig glühend Herz, then, Ganymedean purposiveness implicates a subjective form that aims to enhance the subjectivity of his lyrical counterpart, rather than simply dissolve and cancel it. That is to say, as a subjective form, Ganymede begins moving through his surroundings, much like a Promethean subject, in search of objects he can conceptually shape or grasp according to his own image of them, dass ich dich fassen möchte in diesen Arm. As his journey continues, however, and after a moment of weakening self-awareness in his largely unreflected subjective state of mind, ach, an deinem Busen lieg ich machte, he experiences the things around him more intensely as animated objects, each with its own subjective aim, and each pressing him on, drängen, to pursue that aim. Despite provisionally participating in a whitehead gathering of things in the unity of prehension, however, the here and now that Ganymede stakes out during this transitional moment of memory and expectation contrasts sharply with the hier sitz ich, or self-satisfied presence of Promethean subjectivity. With the renegade thief of Zeus's fire, in fact, we have the exemplary homo faber who, driven to concentrate, specify, and individuate his existence through the supremacy of the personal pronoun ich. Like Lucifer in Goethe's creation myth in Dichtung und Wahrheit, whose name is etymologically related with the morning star Venus and light, he is no more or less than a series of primary acts of pure self-construction, Prometheus is, or a subject subsumed under the Goethean verb, sich verselbsten. Accordingly, it is no accident that his poem ends emphatically with his annunciation of the imperial ich. And then there's Ganymede, who is a counterforce to Promethean self-construction through negative acts of prehension becomes a different kind of subject, subsumed under another Goethe-Neologism, sich entselbstigen. Unlike his counterpart, whose subjectivity is configured in a seated position, Ganymede, who finds himself forever on the move, gradually learns to reflect on his initial desire to grasp and gather like a Promethean subject. As his poem progresses then, he eventually abandons all pretense of Cartesian or Kantian subjectivity in order to dilate, submerge, and dissolve his affective self in the matrix of the animated things crossing his path. Thus empowered by his attachment to objects with their own subjective capacities, Ganymede is launched on a journey of progressive formation and reformation, Bildung um Bildung, that ends in the embrace of a universal generative and creative principle, and I argue the implied return of the textually entwined lovers to the erotically charged environment of luring affect in the hymn's opening strophe. I'll now resume my close reading of Ganymede in order to frame the poem as an unlikely mise-en-scene of Goethe's heterodox reconstruction of the philosophical concept or Begriff, which Einwirkung treats like a collection of Whiteheadian concrescences. Configured as notions or philosophical opinions, these subjective forms of mental activity become the objective data that a Whiteheadian subject superject creates and in turn is shaped by during the process of their reciprocal formation. Goethe in Einwirkung. Für Philosophie im eigentlichen Sinne hatte ich kein Organ. Nur die fortdauernde Gegenwirkung, womit ich der eindringlichen Welt zu widerstehen und sie mir anzueignen genötigt war, musste mich auf eine Methode führen, durch die ich die Meinungen der Philosophin eben auch als wären es Gegenstände zu fassen und mich daran auszubilden suchte. In addition to Whitehead's process philosophy, which the lexemes Organ, Eindringen, Aneignung, Meinung, Gegenstand, Fassen, and Ausbildung in this quotation reference, my reading will refer to Spinoza's modal metaphysics to call attention to related concepts in both Goethe and Whitehead, including Promethean acts of prehension, as well as those Ganymedean feelings or affections of the human body, which in the Ethics 3, Postulate 1, increase or diminish its power of acting. And while Whitehead criticized the introduction of the modes in Spinoza's system as arbitrary and rejected its figuration of God as the principle of the ultimate rather than creativity, he also found Spinoza's system attractive in its modifications of Descartes' position and its subject-predicate forms of thought. According to Stephen Shaviro, in fact, quote, for Whitehead, there's nothing besides the modes, no unified substance that subsumes them, not even immanently. Even God, Whitehead suggests, is natura naturata, as well as natura naturans. Returning to Ganymede then, I'll ask you to consider its conceptual persona as he moves strophe by strophe through the finite modifications of nature and its two attributes, extension and thought, toward the infinite source of their satisfaction. This journey in affection, perception, and satisfaction, which can also be described as a nexus of progressive prehensions, begins in strophe one, where Ganymede joyfully announces his physical and spiritual rebirth within an erotically charged natural landscape that recalls the imminent power of divine generation, designated in the Ethics as natura naturans, or the infinite force field of its own endless modifications, natura naturata. Wie Morgenrot, du ringst mich anglühst, Frühling geliebter, mit tausendfacher Liebeswonne sich an mein Herz drängt, deiner ewigen Wärme heilig Gefühl, unendliche Schön. Here we find the preparatory event in a series of Ganymedean transmutations of Prometheus's unreflected self-determination that, as I've suggested, transformed the Enlightenment version of an autonomous subject into Whitehead's preferred subject-superject constellation. This process of change, moreover, recalls Spinoza's second postulate in Book Two about the capacity of the human body to retain impressions or changes. As another example of the Spinozan mind-body parallelism, it seems, the sacred feeling of warmth that triggers Ganymede's journey in philosophical conceptualization will also produce changes in the placement of his body and the articulation of his extended arm. And the traces of these physical changes will mark Ganymede's mind as well, as it changes the direction of its subjective aim from that of a Cartesian Kantian subject to a Whiteheadian subject superject. In a series of fragmentary observations about Kant and Schelling from around 1800, that the editors of the Weimar edition collected and published as a supplement to volume 11 of Goethe's scientific works under the heading Zur Philosophie, Goethe locates the self configured as a Promethean subject in a Cartesian Kantian place, wo das Subjekt sich über alles Objekt erhebt. The same paralipomenon, however, continues by apodictically asserting what is destined to happen during the process of self-determination. Selbstbestimmung muss ins Objekt übergehen, freies Handeln unser Objekt. Translated into the prolix language that Whitehead's process philosophy uses to frame the subject-superject complex, this enigmatic observation could read, I'm quoting Whitehead now, the process of concrescence is a progressive integration of feelings controlled by their subjective forms. In this synthesis, feelings of an earlier phase sink into the components of some more complex feeling of a later phase. Thus, each phase adds its elements of novelty until the final phase in which the one complex satisfaction is reached. Thus, the actual entity, as viewed morphologically through its satisfaction, is novel in reference to any one of its component feelings. It presupposes that those feelings, unquote. That is to say, the culminating Ich in Goethe's Prometheus, which satisfies the subjective aim of its conceptual persona toward self-determination, Selbstbestimmung, and autonomous creativity, is also paradoxically actualized in its necessary passage, muss übergehen, into an object, unser Objekt, or collective opportunity for future creative activity, freies Handeln. Accordingly, for both Whitehead and Goethe, the process of subject formation is one of creative advance. As such, it integrates the subjective aims of all past and future participants to make new objects Gegenstände, whether these participants are persons, the concepts they create, or the conceptual personae who, according to Deleuze and Guattari, inhabit philosophical writing. And in all these cases, we witness what Whitehead describes as the ingression or Einwirkung of an eternal object of pure potentiality into other less permanent objects. Or to translate the process of creative advance back into Goethe's language of philosophical conceptualization. To comprehend any philosophical notion fully, the philosopher must imagine each newly emerging concept in reciprocal engagement with related conceptual objects or doxes from the tradition. As a formative process, philosophical conceptualization involves the serial reconstruction and synthesis of these Meinungen, opinions, notions, doxes, which as ideal objects of conceptual desire are themselves informed by a capacity not only to be acted upon, but to act. With this brief performance of Goethe's thinking with Whitehead about subjectivity as a process, we can now better appreciate how the first strophe of Ganymede begins integrating the subjective form named Prometheus into the gradually emerging subject-superject configuration named Ganymede. As I already laid out, each of these conceptual personae who undergo a concrescence or grow together into a constructive pairing shares negative or positive feelings for a divinity that is temporally and spatially over there, and so available for their prehensions. Prometheus, of course, first took the god's sacred fire from Olympus down to Earth, where his heilig glühend Herz received and converted it into the glowing hearth within his sheltering hut, dessen Glut du mich beneidest. Unwittingly contained, umfasst, and sustained, erhalten by the flame, which in Whitehead's terminology has become objective data, the Titan concludes his narrative of self-determination, naively sitting at a glowing potter's kiln, shaping terracotta human beings, and celebrating the concentration of his power as a subject into the pronoun ich. I take, I shape, and create, therefore I am. What differentiates Ganymede's subjective form and its characteristic grasping from this can already be seen at his journey's outset. For he finds himself poised to begin moving through his surroundings, unlike the firmly seated and situated Prometheus, whose heilig glühend Herz promises to guarantee his full satisfaction as an autonomous subject. In fact, as the crucial adverb rings suggests, Ganymede already finds himself positioned not in commanding control above, but rather within an alluring environment, umgebung, of vibrant activity that has absorbed and reconstituted the sacred glowing heart of Promethean self-completion, as evidenced in the glowing red shimmer, glance of the rising sun. Within Ganymede's world, it is not just his heart that has agency, but the sacred and warm feeling of the spring's glowing and penetrating gaze. Wie im Morgen rot, or in another version, Morgen glanz, du ringst mich anglühst, Frühling geliebter. We are reminded here of Werther's famous letter of May 10th, which also privileges an intense feeling of exhilaration eine wunderbare Heiterkeit, as a source of complete satisfaction, die ich mit ganzem Herzen genieße. This feeling, moreover, and not the sweet spring mornings that triggered it, momentarily contains and sustains Werther, hat meine ganze Seele eingenommen, and thereby conditions him to re-engage with the world as an aesthetic subject, that according to Shaviro, quote, does not impose its forms upon an otherwise chaotic world, but is itself informed by the world outside. That is to say, this subject also thinks like a Ganymedean subject superject, whose being is animated and actualized by the influence, Einwirkung, ingression, and agency of an alluring feeling of warmth that belongs to the infinite beauty of spring. Mit tausendfacher Liebeswonne sich an mein Herz drängt, deiner ewigen Wärme, heilig Gefühl, unendliche Schöne. According to Shaviro, quote, the contemplated object perpetuates itself in and for the contemplating subject. The subject subsists only to the extent that it resonates with the feelings inspired by that object. Or restated in the words of this reading, the Promethean subject subsists only by becoming a Ganymedean, that is Whiteheadian, subject superject. As such, it must respond to the affective push it receives from the animated objects it encounters outside itself. From the third strophe on, then, which witnesses the weakening of Ganymede's Promethean grip onto things, and so too a relaxing of this restrictive form of subjectivity, we can now follow step by step his rhythmically structured encounters with the surrounding world. Significantly, Goethe initiates the progressive passage of the emerging subject-superject with the interjection ach, which according to my fellow GLPC editor, John H. Smith, hi John, embodies Goethe's dialectical understanding of the conjunction of materiality and spirituality, unquote, and as the enactment of a taking of breath also, quote, captures a caesura within being that is comparable to the transitions between inhalation and exhalation, unquote. Accordingly, at this point in this reading, we can now also take a deep breath and follow Ganymede through a critical point of inflection that advances him toward mutual embrace with the things he encounters. As he progresses along this new arc of discovery, he will learn to treat these things self-reflexively as opportunities to value his own affective capacity to connect with other subjectivities. The philosophy of substance, according to Whitehead, propose a subject which then encounters a datum and then reacts to that datum. The philosophy of organism presupposes a datum which is met with feelings and progressively attains the unity of a subject, or more properly, superject. Since time is now short, I can't examine line by line the series of prehensive events that the poem successively stages as Ganymede feels and processes the collective effects or Einwirkungen on his body and mind of the surrounding ecosystem of flowers and grass or wind, birds, and mist become clouds. When he addresses his outstretched and grasping arm with the demonstrative pronoun dies, however, rather than the first person possessive pronoun that Prometheus uses 8 times, he also implicitly acknowledges the reflexive awareness at work in his own comprehensive capacity to grasp the world in its essential reality as process. If the subject of substance philosophy is to become the subject superject of the philosophy of organism, it must absorb into its own subjectivity the objectivity of all of its affective encounters with the world, which also means recognizing a reciprocal subjective capacity within objects to occasion feelings in their prehending subjects. This crucial textual point of inflection for Goethean subjectivity happens in the fourth strophe of the poem's manuscript version, which consists of just 2 lines. Each of the lines repeats the same lexeme, and each also features 2 exclamation points to suggest that something eventful is happening, that it's becoming an occasion in Whitehead's terms with each successive utterance. In the second line, moreover, the repeated lexemes are separated by the second ach in the poem. Ich komme, wohin, ach, wohin. In light of my thesis about the transformation of Ganymedean subjectivity from naive self-determination to reflexive self-awareness, it seems reasonable to consider the doubled verbal phrase ich komme and the double preposition wohin as markers that reflect the reciprocal engagement of their constitutive lexemes. The initial repetition is of the first person pronoun, which functions as the grammatical subject of each verbal phrase. In the manuscript version of the first iteration of the verb drops the personal ending, however, the E, while the second iteration retains it. The less formal usage without the required inflection suggests a more naive speaker, I, who is unaware of grammatical rules and unmotivated to reflect on their application. Conversely, the fully inflected form ich komme suggests a grammatical reflection by a more sophisticated speaker, I, who understands and accepts the application of the rules of inflection in word construction. Additionally, this repetition with a difference implies that the double verbs are aiming at different meanings. Could the ich komme of the first iteration connote arrival, for example, or a state of just being somewhere, while the ich komme of the second iteration is saying, I'm on my way or in transition? If so, then the first subject is more settled than the second, who is therefore more likely to undergo change. In light of this kind of reciprocal engagement of contrasting words, moreover, we might also want to interrogate the repetition of vohin, where the two words are joined and separated by the animating interjection ach. So if I might ask a question again, could the first vohin suggest a primitive awareness upon arrival that the naive subject is confused? He senses that his place has changed, that he is there and not here, but he cannot say exactly where this new place is. By contrast, the second, self-reflexive subject understands that his subjectivity is a process with an aim, as a vector of potentiality constituted by the accidents of as yet unpredictable encounters. He is not confused by his vohin, but confident that wherever it might land him, he will experience the satisfaction of self-completion. As Ganymede spirals upward in the poem's final strophe, then, we encounter two additional markers that I want to consider in concluding this preliminary framing of the poem's trajectory as an exploration of the role that the contrasting subject aims of Goethe's two conceptual personae play as they either sit or move through their respective worlds, all the while physically and mentally grabbing and grasping and trying to get a grip on the things they encounter. The first marker, Mia, Mia, is again a doubled lexeme, again followed by two exclamation points that seem to be saying, take note. Do you have a concept that comprehends what I'm doing? Data and objective data play key roles in Whitehead's understanding of process and creative advance as a system of prehensions and concrescences. As Cobb explains, every feeling has a datum. The datum is for that occasion an object, so Whitehead calls it an objective datum. But it's important to recognize that the objective datum was a moment ago a subject. The objective datum is chiefly composed of feelings. The world is made up of feelings, of feelings, of feelings. The objective datum is what the feeling feels and what is given to it, that is its datum. Now, even if Goethe did not systematize the conceptual methodology underlying his morphological Begrifflichkeit as explicitly or extensively as Whitehead, there are instructive moments in his poetry that use dative rather than nominative or accusative forms to reconfigure subjectivity and conceptualization as a Whiteheadian process. These include most prominently the opening verse of My Lied, My Fest, the Herrlich leuchtet mir die Natur, which uses an intransitive verb with a dative object as the predicate of the grammatical subject Natur, as well as the dative inflection of subjectivity then in the fourth strophe of Ganymede. In both of these examples, we are reminded of Walter's lyrical description, again in the letter of May 10, of the chaotic sensations that are generated by the teeming life forms all around him, das wimmelnde kleine Welt zwischen Hamel. These feelings, we learn, press his heart, and as he says, become noteworthy for him, mir merkwürdig werden. That is to say, the datum given to Walter as a prehending subject is actually a feeling that links his subjectivity to an affective source. Accordingly, as in the case of Ganymede, the first Mia in the poem is the recipient of a feeling generated by an objective datum, which in turn is itself changed by the occasion of its giving. This objective datum of the first Mia therefore becomes the second Mia of the verse, and in mutual exchange with the first one, it moves along a parallel path in a pulsating process of reciprocal embrace and release. And by growing together through a series of successive prehensions by superseding entities, this nexus of subjective-objective concrescences produces an enhanced levels of satisfaction in its paired forms. Ultimately, then, the subject-superject Ganymede embodies an enhanced capacity to be fully contained or comprehended within the force field of its own process of becoming. A thick description of the conceptual persona's journey through and within philosophical conceptualization, to be sure. especially in light of Goethe's two-word description of this movement, which promises to satisfy Ganymede's subjective aim as subject and superject, umfangend, umfangend. Ganymede utters this summarizing phrase of his conceptual journey with no punctuation mark separating them, inextricably joins two different participles of the German verb that variously means to clasp, grab, or grip, to surround, to envelop, or to embrace. All of them versions, I would add, of Whitehead's to prehend, which in light of his theory of successive prehensions by superseding entities in process and reality should also include to comprehend. As the clouds drift downward in Ganymede's view and his field of vision clears then, he imagines an uplifting journey of subjective satisfaction that turns on the axis of this active-passive construction. However incomplete, Ganymede's Promethean drive drive to grab, grasp, or clasp and hold on to the multitude of vibrant things within his reach initially configures his subjective form with the present participle umfangend. But this is just part of his story. Like the Knabe or Ephebe who is held at the end of Goethe's essay of 1772 on Gothic architecture, first as another deified Hercules, who was reborn and transfigured, and then as an intensified Prometheus, Ganymede comes to land in the embrace of an all-loving progenitor. Fully contained and content, that is umfangen, within the generative region of divine creativity, natura naturans, he touches the chest of the divine father, and so, at least in the reader's imagination, appears poised to descend in mutual embrace with the alam fasa, and more than Prometheus, mea'as Prometheus, is directed to return the Seligkeit der Götter, or the blessedness of the gods, back to the earth. That's the end of von Deutscher Baukunst. Spinozistic blessedness, according to Don Garrett, Seligkeit, consists in adequate philosophical and scientific knowledge of God or nature. By that measure, it aims at the same satisfaction as the conceptual persona Ganymede, or for that matter, as Goethe's living concept, lebendiger Begriff, which in the manner of Spinoza's three stages of cognition, or Leibniz's perception and apperception, or Whitehead's creative advance, generates sequences of cognitive moves and moments of transitional comprehension that stand in close relation to each other and can be gathered in graded series to be saved for future prehensions, reflections, and reconfigurations. Just about done. The nature which is in fact apprehended in awareness, Whitehead once mused, holds within it the greenness of the trees, the sun of the birds, the hardness of the chairs, and the feel of velvet. The nature which is the cause of awareness is the conjectured system of molecules and electrons, which so affects the mind so as to produce the awareness of apparent nature. The meeting point of these two natures is in the mind, unquote. Another more specific meeting point I would add in conclusion is the poetic mind that gave us Prometheus and Ganymede. Thanks for your attention.